Hey guys, Digitech Lifestyle here, back with another video. This one's on trade talks and the meeting that's happening in New York at the moment. This guy, David Weisinger, I think he's in the Weisberger, is going to explain why many countries or companies, sorry, are moving out of the US to do any business with them, quite simply because of the lack of regulatory clarity that is in the US, and as an entrepreneur, how frustrating that is, and how much more money he's making outside of the US with his business as opposed to inside the US, which is ridiculous in my view. But there you go, let's listen.
Welcome to Nasdaq Trade Talks. I'm Jill Melandrino, Global Markets Reporter at Nasdaq. We're coming to you live from Mainnet 2023 in New York City. And joining us for this segment, we have Dave Weisberger, co-CEO of CoinRoutes, to discuss how the lack of crypto regulatory framework is a barrier for the U.S. to be competitive in the digital asset space. Dave, it's great to see you as always. Welcome back to Trade Talks. You've been on my show literally since day one, 6.5 years ago.
Always a pleasure.
And the one thing I know about you is your reputation has been built on structure. And the fact that we have this lack of regulatory framework has to be eating you up.
It really is problematic. Look, the way I explain it to anyone who cares is that the world is going digital. We understand that in every facet of our lives. Today, the US has, and has had for about 40 years, the best capital markets in the world. We have the most efficient analog markets. We have squeezed every bit of efficiency we can out of analog markets where actually paper certificates are in vaults below DTCC. And the fact is that has given trillions of dollars of excess GDP to the US. It has created millions of jobs here as founders from all around the world come to the US to raise money, and pools of capital from all around the world come to the US to invest. Now imagine a world where the U.S. is the last to adopt digital technologies, and we go from the most efficient capital markets to the least efficient capital markets. That is a very bad thing, and it's incredibly hard for me to understand why the politicians in D.C. that are forming the anti-crypto army don't get what's at stake, because what is at stake is nothing more than American business primacy, and it is a very big deal. So yes, I am very worked up on the issue.
Right. Well, I mean, we're starting to see it now where the blockchain and crypto talent pool, I think it's like 68% of it is overseas at this point. But the fact that we don't want to be at the start of it developing the infrastructure around it is problematic, as you're well aware of. And that infrastructure is being developed ex-US.
And even those of us US entrepreneurs, we founded CoinRoutes at the beginning of 17. And, you know, we are a growing company. We process billions of dollars through our platform. The vast majority of our clients, almost 95% of them, it's non-US money. And most of our clients are overseas, and all our growth is overseas, and we're growing overseas. That is insane to me as an American, a patriotic American business person, that I have to move overseas. Now, we're about to announce innovative products in DeFi, which will bring DeFi and CeFi together in a way that is incredibly important as we try to navigate the future of digital assets. And we're going to have to do so in a way that excludes all U.S. clients and excludes all U.S. money. And okay, right. So be it, but that's fine for us, but it's not good for the world. It's not good for the U.S. And frankly, it's only because we have no regulatory guardrails, no regulatory clarity around what is a security, how do securities get treated, and the people who claim that you can are lying. I mean, we watched a congressional hearing, which was a farce. Aaron Kaplan from Promethean. The man looked straight out of Central Casting as the villain in an 80s Wall Street movie. The fact of the matter is, when tokens or digital assets are created through distributed autonomous organizations, those facts and all the facts investors care about are completely unable to be put on SEC disclosure forms. You cannot disclose token economics. You cannot disclose supply schedules. You cannot disclose ownership. You cannot disclose governance. Those are the important things. Now, Massari, the host of this conference, that's exactly what they have. They actually have that information. Working with a company like them, the regulators could actually move forward. But instead, they've taken a, no, we don't want to validate.
What are the roadblocks? Is it the optics? the perceived optics behind?
You know, we've gone through 6 years of what people in this room will call FUD, fear, uncertainty, and doubt. So people make up things about Bitcoin. They say, oh, it's only good for terrorists. Yet the FBI, and I've heard people from the FBI, the people who run enforcement of the FBI, love it when they use Bitcoin. When the bad guys use Bitcoin, it is much easier to trace than cash. They love it. I asked them point blank, why don't they say so publicly, which would counteract this FUD? And the answer is, we don't want the bad guys to know that. We want them to keep using it. So, unfortunately, politicians harp on things that are untrue. The environment. They claim that Bitcoin is bad because it uses a lot of electricity. Sure, but it's the single best way to incentivize renewables because of the uneven economics of renewables. People like Nick Carter from Castle Island Ventures write about this constantly, and it's all clear. But unfortunately, what's really happening is incumbent financial layers, if you read Clayton Christensen's Innovator's Dilemma, always fight against disruption, and they have enlisted the government or people in the government to fight for them. And that's what's really going on. And it's unfortunate because this industry wants to work with people in the government like Tom Emmers, Warren Davidson, Patrick McHenry, Kristen Gillibrand, Cynthia Lummis, Richie Torres. I mean, it should be both parties. It isn't just Republican, but it's becoming an issue. Right. And that's what really bothers us. It should be a bipartisan issue.
Well, I mean, that's why you see other areas of the world, Southeast Asia, you're seeing in Africa, you're seeing in South America, that don't have those legacy institutional assets like we do in the U.S. So they don't have these barriers that they have to overcome. Even like their infrastructure, transportation systems, it's all brand new because you don't have these legacy systems that you have to integrate and all the, let's call it, bureaucracy that comes with that.
Right. But even Europe with MiCA is developing a framework, or the UK, the FCA is developing a framework. Japan has a framework. Switzerland has a framework. We are literally the only major developed nation who has no framework or approach for digital assets in law. Now, there's a bill, the FID Act, which actually is a really good start, would start trigger conversations. And there's another one that Gillibrand and Senators Gillibrand, who's going to talk tomorrow, I guess, and Cynthia Lummis have put forward. But they don't have the support of the administration. They don't have the support of, as Vivek would say from yesterday, the three-letter agencies or the four-letter agencies to move forward. And that's what needs to happen. We need to understand that becoming digital assets and the development of that is as important as putting someone on the moon. It is literally going to transform the financial system to be a global system where anyone around the world can buy any asset around the world, a multi-currency system where you can buy the same asset without friction in dollars or euro or yen or whatever, a much more efficient system where stable coins can have instant 24/7 payments without the headaches and the fees that you do with wire transfers. And all of that from and with better information that's on chain and off chain to understand how assets go. That future is really exciting. It could open a wave of entrepreneurship that we haven't seen in the world since the Industrial Revolution. But you're not going to get that, at least in the United States, if you don't have a structure around it where entrepreneurs know we don't have to worry about, hey, we're going to sue you and put you out of business.
Do you think part of it is, okay, so we know the fee structure is going to have to change at banks. You know, there's going to be middle people that are going to come out of the equation. It seems as if we're thinking short term about that and not about the longer term ability to transact globally.
I mean, that is absolutely true. But here's a fun fact for you, because I like to make people understand. CoinRoute's clients, now this is a bit of an ad. I hate to do advertising, but it makes a point. We analyzed about $12 billion worth of institutional trades, defined as over $200,000, and compared the cost of executing those trades in spot crypto to the cost of trading U.S. and foreign equities. According to Bloomberg, U.S. equities institutional trades on average cost somewhere in the neighborhood of 15 basis points from the midpoint, or 11 for orders that are smaller than 5% of ADV. CoinRoute's institutional orders, average size about $2 million of spot crypto. You can make up your mind what percent of ADV is. The average cost is somewhere in the neighborhood between 7 and 8 basis points. So we already have seen the competitive advantages of a system that, yeah, it may seem crazy that you could have cross markets. It may seem crazy that tick sizes aren't regulated. But we have much less high frequency trading. We have much lower barriers to entry for people to trade. And a firm like ours is able to deliver results that are literally better in an asset class that people consider the Wild West than in equities. Now, Yeah, it's an ad for us, but it also shows the power of innovation. And that's what people need to understand. Innovation will drive efficiencies. It will drive adoption. It will drive the market forward. It will help entrepreneurs. It will result in jobs. And that's really what people in the financial market, that's why I'm so passionate about this. I spent 40 years on Wall Street before I jumped into crypto. And the reality is, I feel that my firm is doing good, really doing good, like going to help people do things that will matter. I see it in Miami when I wear my CoinRoute shirt. I always am in conversations. I don't care if I'm at a barbershop where we get into a crypto conversation, or a house painter comes to visit me, or an electrician, or I go into a store. Inevitably, people from all walks of life are interested in crypto and digital assets. You don't get the same thing if you wear a Morgan Stanley shirt. I mean, seriously, it is much more inclusive. And that's why it's very hard for me to understand how this isn't becoming a much bigger political issue, although I suspect it will.
Dave, appreciate the insight as always. Thanks for joining us on Trade Talks. And thanks for joining me. I'm Jill Melandrino, Global Market Reporter at NASDAQ.
Here you're going to hear from Gary Gensler talking about compliance, talking about regulations, talking about people doing nefarious things, etc., etc., yet losing cases against him where he's brought accusations against companies and the laws have said, no, that is not the case. Or the law courts have said that's not the case. Let's hear from where he's what he's trying to explain.
When you take collectively recent court decisions we have seen, how have they made you, Gary Gensler, think differently about regulating this space?
I'll tell you, I think the same thing. It's about ensuring for compliance and protecting the investing public. And this is a field, it kind of reminds me a bit of the 1920s securities markets, 100 years ago, where a lot of people were getting hurt. And Congress came along and said, we've got to clean that up. And of course, we had the Great Depression. And the securities laws apply to crypto security tokens. And there's nothing incompatible with those tokens.
But the courts have just said Ripple is not a security, given that they have used the definitions of the Howey test, which is a law in the USA, which Ripple has, the token has passed. It is not a security. So he's trying again to weasel his way out by not even thinking about. He's just saying securities. Well,
with the securities laws, investors still benefit from disclosure, and investors get to choose based on that disclosure. Investors benefit from laws against fraud and manipulation and other conflicts in the markets. And we've just seen so many people hurt and lost their money, hoping for a better future.
Due to lack of regulations. That's why. Due to lack of regulations. He was in bed with FTX or that, and he knew about the others that have failed, Celsius, BlockFi, all those other companies that he gave, or Clayton, I think it was, that gave the green light to, and yet they failed for some unknown reason. Why? Why did they fail? Because they have not, they didn't do their, they said they did their due diligence with the SEC, they went in and met them, etc., etc., especially the FTX case, which is now something that's major in the news right now, where the parents are now involved. Come on, come on, stop.
And there's so many hucksters and fraudsters in this field.
And so nothing any court would say would change your mind on that.
I wish something a court could say which would actually bring the compliance sooner, but this was a field that was built as a global field, so a lot of it's outside of the US, and we have very robust securities laws in this country. Um, having said that, there are a lot of folks in this field that are trying to say, well, those don't apply.
They've been coming in, they've been trying to, Ripple, for one, came in and saw the SEC before they got sued. They are a very transparent company. They are making waves in the financial markets with many countries and many companies. Digitech Lifestyle app, like and subscribe.